Om Asatoma Satkamayam Tamasoma Jyotirgamayam Mrityorma Amritam Gamayam Aviravir Mahedhi Rudrayate Takshinam Mukham Tenamam Pahi Nityam. May the Divine lead us from the unreal to the real, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. May the Divine Consciousness fill our hearts and protect us. So this day-long celebration of Swami Vivekananda's birthday that we are observing today, every year when we celebrate Swamiji's birthday and also the Jayanti of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, it's a day of great joy for every one of us. There is a big puja, there is singing, there is music, there is flower offering, and there is a very delicious prasad. But every celebration that we have, there is a public aspect to it and there is a private aspect. Take Griha Pravesham for instance. So if you buy a new home, then we have a special puja, we invite relatives, family, friends. Now that's the public aspect of that celebration. But after all the guests have left, all the packing and unpacking and arranging things in the new home, that is done privately. That's not a public function anymore. So similarly, every celebration has a public aspect and a private aspect. So we can ask this question today, this public celebration of Swami Vivekananda's birthday, that's one aspect. What does a private celebration of Swami Vivekananda's birthday mean? One way of understanding that is, if we are celebrating Swamiji's birthday, Swamiji was born now more than 150 years ago. He's born, he passed away in 1902, that's it. How can a person who lived such a long time away, what can that person do to us? So Swamiji, as a historical person, lived and passed away at a certain point in history. Inspiring, but nothing much we can do about it. But people of Swamiji's caliber do not simply live on the historical plane. They also have a spiritual dimension. And it is the spiritual dimension of Swamiji that continues to protect us, to guide us, and to help us even today. So to celebrate Swamiji's birthday would be to also observe the birthday of not just the historical Vivekananda, but also the spiritual Vivekananda. And that birthday of the spiritual dimension of Swamiji, that is not a public celebration. That's a private celebration that occurs in our own heart. What does it mean for Swamiji to be born in our own heart? One way of understanding that is to say, to what extent does Swamiji continue to live in me? And Swamiji living in me means the way I think, the way I relate with other people, the way I do my work, the way I speak, how much of my thoughts, my words, and my actions are influenced by Swami Vivekananda's life and personality. Because otherwise, it's possible to have these public celebrations and then return home next day and continue with our life as usual. Nothing changes. Until next year, we meet again and then once again celebrate. So this private celebration of Swamiji's birthday is very important. Without that, the public celebration is not of much value. One way of discovering or creating the right conditions in our heart for Swamiji to be born within us is to study his words very carefully. Just take a little water. Sometimes when we speak about scriptures, we usually think about the Gita, the Upanishads and so on. Oftentimes we do not look upon Swamiji's works as the scripture in itself. And that is because we somehow think if it's a scripture, if it's a Shastra, it has got to be very old. It has got to be in Sanskrit. Now Swamiji's books are old, but not that old, not as old as the Gita. And they are not in Sanskrit, most of it. And therefore, because we apparently think that we understand English enough or understand in whichever language they are translated, we think they don't need to then look upon it as a scripture. So we did an experiment back in Boston where I live. We have a scripture class every Wednesday. And normally, we study Sanskrit scriptures there, the Gita, the Upanishads, the Panchadashi and so on. And so a few months ago, as an observance of 125 years of the Chicago addresses, so we thought, let's study Swamiji's Chicago addresses as a part of a scriptural study. And the fascinating thing was, the feedback that we got was that this made much more relevance, much more sense to the people attending it, not only at the center, but also those who followed it via podcast or online. And the reason was Swamiji put the same ancient truths in a language, in an idiom that today we can understand and appreciate. Sister Nivedita says that when Swamiji began to speak at the Parliament of Religions, he began to speak about the religious ideas of the Hindus. But when he had finished, Hinduism had been created. Now what exactly is meant by Hinduism being created? In some sense, we can say that every great reformer within the tradition has kind of recreated the tradition. When the Buddha came, when Shankaracharya came, and then of course in our own times, Sri Ramakrishna came, and then Swamiji, what they did was to take the same ancient truths and present it in a language through symbols, through metaphors and examples that today we can understand. Among the things that Swamiji did for us, we could say that one thing he did was to show us how to connect the bridge between religion and spirituality. Oftentimes we treat these two words, religion and spirituality, as almost similar. And probably they are. But increasingly, there is a big section, especially among the younger generation today, who like to think of themselves as spiritual but not religious. There is a big, in fact, a growing number, it's a category in itself, especially in the West, but I am sure at least in the major cities in India, a lot of people belonging to the younger generation are not so happy by if someone says that you are a religious person. Being religious is somehow associated with being old-fashioned, with superstitious, and so on. And so, many times, younger generation feel more comfortable thinking of themselves as, I believe in spirituality, but I'm not religious. A part of the reason this thinking occurs is because the word religion has gotten increasingly associated with religious organizations. And organizations have their own problems. While the word spirituality seems more individual, seems something that I have complete control over, while religion seems to have just a set of do's and don'ts, vidhi nisheda, and so many people are not happy with it. One other way of understanding the difference between religion and spirituality is what Swamiji in his Bhakti Yoga, he speaks about Gauni Bhakti and Parabhakti, the preliminary stage of devotion and higher devotion. In the preliminary stages, there are disciplines to be followed, there are rules to be followed, but when we attain that purity of heart, then one goes into that higher stage where there are no really rules. It's just the love of God that takes one. We call it Parabhakti. Religion and spirituality can sometimes be understood as the difference between the preliminary stages of our religious life and an advanced stage of spiritual life. So, going back to that talk that Swamiji gave, the paper on Hinduism that he read in Chicago, among the things that Swamiji referred to, I will just mention a few to point the distinction between religion and spirituality. Swamiji begins that paper on Hinduism by referring to the Vedas, for instance. Now, today, most of us will be able to say, well, there are the four Vedas, the Rig Veda, the Yajur Veda, the Sama Veda, and the Atharva Veda. And we often think about Vedas as books. Oftentimes, people come to our bookstores and ask, do you have a copy of the Vedas? So, Vedas are seen primarily as books. But what does Swamiji say? Swamiji said, by Vedas, no books are meant. By Vedas are meant that accumulated treasury of spiritual laws discovered by sages at different points in history. And that's a very radical statement, that Vedas are not books. Essentially, Vedas are the collection of these great truths. Now, with truths, no one has a monopoly on truth. Not India, not Hinduism. A truth is truly universal. And anyone who opens their heart to it has access to it. Now what this does is that it expands the idea of the Veda, expands the idea of a revealed scripture, not limiting it only to my own little holy book, but to say that wherever there is truth, that text or that source is also included in the Vedas. Now that gives us that breadth to not limit our understanding of religion to only one book, to be able to then find wisdom beyond the borders and the limits that we create, saying this is my religion, that's your religion. And oftentimes when we make that kind of distinction, it's always, my religion is somehow better than your religion. In fact, even as Hindus, we have to be a little humble, the reason I say that is because it's true that there is lots of universal truths in the tradition to which most of us belong. But sometimes we tend to think that We are the real universal ones. All the others are very narrow, very small. We are the real ones. But that's not being universal. That's not what Swamiji meant when he said that the same truths can be found by different points in history by different people. So, we can become, if we are not careful, we can become fanatics ourselves, boasting of our own universality while condemning everyone else. Swami Vivekananda said that one thing he saw about his master, about Sri Ramakrishna, was he never ever condemned anyone. So if we want to have Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother and Swamiji being born in our heart, that's the private celebration, not the external, internal. If Swamiji is to be born in heart, then I must remind myself that God's wisdom or truth can be found not only in the book that is sacred to me, but it can be found in many other places as well. That's what would take me from a narrow concept of religion to a broad understanding of spirituality. About karma, oftentimes the word karma is probably the most misunderstood term, not only abroad but also in our country. We use the word karma in so many different senses. Sense is that everyone has their own idea about karma. And oftentimes, karma is seen as some kind of a burden. It's like we are just like weighed down by this karma. But Swamiji pointed out that karma as a theory, it's a theory. But karma as a theory is an extremely, a theory that gives us control over our whole life. That we are not, karma is not fate. Karma is not destiny. Many of us sometimes tend to think that we have no control over our life. That there are much larger forces outside which are doing things with me and I am just a helpless victim. That my life is not under my own control. But Swamiji's explanation of karma gives me control over my whole life. That's why Swamiji said, you are the creator of your own destiny, that you can shape your own future. And what Swamiji said was that today if I am the result of the way I thought and the actions I did in the past, then what I am going to be tomorrow or in the future will depend on how I think and what I do today. So my future then is in my own hands, is not in the hands of any unseen force. So Swamiji's explanation of karma gives me control over my whole life. That is what a limited understanding of karma would be, what most religious people do. Think upon it as something that we are being controlled by. Well, spirituality would mean, according to Swamiji, that I recognize karma as a way that empowers me, that gives me control over my life. Same thing with regard to our understanding of ourselves. Oftentimes, the phrase that Swami Ranganathanandaji Maharaj often liked to use was static piety. By static piety, he meant that I just follow all the rules. Oh, every Monday I should go to a Shiva temple, I should offer these flowers, I should do this Pushpanjali, I should observe so many days fast. And many of us do it with great devotion and great sincerity. And that's helpful. It will definitely help us in life. But if we don't grow beyond this limited do's and don'ts, then our progress can remain stunted. And so what we need is to transform this static piety into a dynamic spirituality. And how do we do that? And that way would be then not simply to do a certain fast and do a certain kind of pujas, but then ask at some point the question, who is this person who is doing all this thing? Who am I really? Of course, if anyone were to ask the question, who are you? all of us have an answer. You could begin by saying what my name is, where I work, and so on. There are many different ways of answering the question, who are you? But if we really ask ourselves that, where is my I? I, see, like this, simultaneously in life, we have many different identities. So when we are with our parents, then I am a son or a daughter. If you are with your family, then you are a husband or a wife, or you are a father or a mother. If you are in your working in your workplace, then you are an officer or a colleague. So we carry all these different identities, and at appropriate times we switch on and switch off these identities. What we need to ask is, do I have any spiritual identity? And many of us here who come to the mutt regularly, who go to the temples, have an identity. I'm a bhakta, I'm a devotee, and that's good. Then the question that I can ask is, how often in the course of the day do I tell myself I'm a bhakta? Because that is one of the many identities that I have. Now, a sign of growth in our spirituality would be that more and more often my spiritual identity will assert itself than my other identities. And that is what Sri Ramakrishna meant when he said that we should transform the unripe ego to the ripe ego. An unripe ego would be my I that is attached to things and people of this world. The ripe ego would be, there is still the ego, but the ego that is attached to my spiritual ideal, either in a personal aspect or in the impersonal aspect. And of course, in the impersonal way, we have this idea that in reality, I'm not the body, I'm not the mind. There is a deeper truth within me, that deeper reality which was never born, which will never die. The body was born at one time, the body will die. The mind will have its ups and downs. But there is something within me which was never born, which will never die, which never feels depressed, which is always filled with bliss. Unfortunately, so much of our life, we are so busy dealing with our body and mind that most of us are not even aware that there is something else within which is different from body and mind. So one of the often quoted words of Swamiji says, teach yourself, teach everyone their true nature. And when that true nature becomes awakened, to the phrase that Swamiji uses is self-conscious activity. So when that self becomes awakened through the self-conscious activity, Swamiji says, truth will come, purity will come, freedom will come, everything that is grand and noble will come when this real me, the spiritual me, becomes awakened. But that's one other aspect that Swamiji stressed in that first talk he gave at the Chicago Parliament. The nature of the Atman, that I should not think of myself as simply this very vulnerable human being who has born at some day, getting older day by day, and one day going to die. Yes, that's what the body is going to do, whether we like it or not. But there's something within me which will always remain fresh. The more often we remember that, the more spiritual we are. The more often we forget that, the more worldly that we have become. So, who is a worldly person, who is a spiritual person, is not to be determined by who goes how often to the mutt, or who never reads any spiritual books. Those are very superficial ways of deciding who is worldly and who is spiritual. But a real way to determine whether someone is spiritual or worldly is to, it's very difficult to judge other people. We can just judge our own selves and ask within, deep in our heart, in that private celebration, How often do I think of my spiritual identity? And how often I am busy dealing with the things of this world? That is another one important point that Swamiji stressed in that. Yet another thing that Swamiji stressed was about the religion itself, the societies in which we live today, in any part of the world, are becoming increasingly diverse. Sure, that in different parts of the world, a certain community might be in the majority, some others may be in minority, and there is all this legal, political tangle always going on about minority rights and what the majority can do, and that there is no end to it. Go to any point in history, in any part of the world, there's always been this fight that the people who are in the majority with a certain identity want to control or exploit the others, and the others fight back, and so on. This is going on everywhere. Now, if I participate in that kind of thinking, then I have no right to call myself spiritual. I need to find a creative way to deal with diversity while remaining firm in my own identity. And all of us who find our spiritual sustenance at the mutt, we have this glowing example of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother and Swamiji, where there really should be no doubt whatsoever that no matter which religious book a person follows or what the way they pray, the kind of place of worship they go to, whether it's a temple or a mosque or a church, that it's this human heart that is crying out to the divine. If I can understand that, if I can look beyond the superficialities, then my love in religious life will not remain limited only to people of whom I see as my religious people, people belonging to the same religion as me. If I can make no distinction whatsoever, but people who love God, irrespective of whether they worship God, the kind of God that I worship, or if they read the spiritual book, the kind of book that I read. That is a Swamiji says in an extremely inspiring passage in his lecture on the ideal of a universal religion. Swamiji says, and these are his words, I'm not quoting it exactly, but the idea, and he says, I can go to a temple and sit in meditation. I'm happy to go in a mosque and pray there. I can go and kneel before the crucifix. He mentions all these different places of worship, and Swamiji says he can feel completely at peace, completely comfortable going to all these places and know that the same divine being is worshipped there. And of course, in Sri Ramakrishna's life, we know that he, in fact, very radically, we don't have to really practice all religions, but Sri Ramakrishna did it, and did it to show us that while we can remain rooted in our own tradition, if I have even the least bit of hatred or anger or suspicion about some people who are different from me, I'm not really a true devotee of Ramakrishna, Holy Mother and Swamiji. If I want Swamiji to be born in my heart, then I have to make sure. And that's why reading Swamiji's words very carefully is important. Not just saying, oh, I've read that book. No, it doesn't happen that way. So, Swamiji writes in one letter to Alasinga Perumal, I think. He said, I want to leave some books behind which will be like textbooks. And we really don't know which book Swamiji meant. But it just feels like the four yogas of Swamiji that we have today are the kind of textbooks Swamiji meant for not only his generation, but the generations that came after him, you and me, for all of us. It's oftentimes not recognized that the four yogas is actually Swamiji's invention. Sometimes people tend to think that these four yogas in the Hindu tradition is a very ancient formulation. It is not. The words Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, the words were existed. But to divide the entire spiritual sadhana, the discipline, into four categories, that was never done before Swamiji. So how did Swamiji do it? Swamiji didn't mean some specific things that this is Jnana Yoga, this is Karma Yoga. That was not the idea at all. What Swamiji did was actually a universal way of categorizing spiritual practice. And very briefly, it's this, that irrespective of what religion we belong to, we are all human beings. Well, there are cats and others here, and they might have their own religion, but I can't speak their language and they don't speak my language. So I'm only addressing human beings now. So as human beings, we all have a mind, and the mind has certain functions. And it's possible to see at least three major functions of the human mind. One is the cognitive function. Cognitive means the power of the mind to apply reason, to apply logic. That's one function of the mind. The second function of the mind is called the affective function. And that is the ability of the mind to use the power of feelings, the power of emotion. So that's the second thing. So the power of reason, the power of emotions. And a third function of the mind is the power of the will, the willpower. So these are the three major powers that the mind learns to use and manipulate and employ. And what Swamiji did was that any spiritual practice, not just the practice within Hinduism, but any spiritual practice anywhere in the world at any point in history, if it predominantly uses the power of reason and logic, all of those practices will come under Jnana Yoga. So Jnana Yoga is not some fixed thing. So if your religious practice is predominantly using logic and reason, that can be categorized under Jnana Yoga. Similarly, those religious practices which predominantly use emotions and feelings, purifying the emotions, purifying the feelings, all of those practices can be categorized under Bhakti Yoga. Now the willpower, now there are certain spiritual practices which predominantly use the power of the will. As it applies in the world, the work that we do, and we need the power of the will in the work that we do in the external world. All of those practices which uses willpower as it applies to work, that comes under Karma Yoga. And the same power of the will, when employed in the inner working of the mind, then those practices are called Raja Yoga. So you can see that these four yogas are very open categories. They are just like four baskets. And we can look at any of the spiritual practices and decide for ourselves to which basket they belong to. Now, none of these practices are exclusive. We can never say, oh, this practice is only logic or only emotion. It's never like that. What it means is, most of it might belong to one category, but it might also have a little bit of the other. So this is a very fluid differences. So one way of having this private celebration of Swamiji's birth in our own heart is to study these four yogas of Swamiji with great attention, with great care. Even if you have read it before, I would encourage you to once again take up these books and read them carefully. And it's just possible to keep on reading and feel we have understood it, but that doesn't help. So adhyayana, study, means adhyayana. But the word that gets often used is swadhyaya. Now swadhyaya means the sva before that adhyaya. That sva can also be interpreted to mean that whatever I read, I need to apply to my own life. It's not enough to just, when Swamiji says, be truthful, be honest, and say, oh, that's very nice teaching. Doesn't help. Swadhyaya would mean, how do I, when I wake up tomorrow morning, how do I become, what do I need to do in order to be truthful, to be honest? Which are the instances in my daily life when I'm not so truthful, when I'm not so honest? That kind of application of Swamiji's words to our own life, then that study will become a real Swadhyaya. And one can almost give a guarantee that if we study Swamiji's yogas in this way, slowly, carefully, there is no rush to finish it quickly. This is not a running race. But even if an imperfect study and an imperfect practice of Swamiji's yogas, we'll find, will radically change our life. And ultimately, that is what counts. It does not matter for how many years you are coming to the mat. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter how many books you have read, how many lectures you have attended. Nothing matters. What really matters is, am I today a better person than what I was 5 years ago or 10 years ago? Otherwise, I can keep on reading books, I can keep on attending all the pujas, I can keep on enjoying all the prasad, and yet at the end of it, fine, nothing much has changed. I've just gotten a bit older, that's all. That's not spirituality. So spirituality would mean, I should feel within my own heart, yes, I am a better person now. That if I had not read Swamiji, if I had not read about Holy Mother and Sri Ramakrishna, a great part, something would have been lost from my life. That is what ultimately matters, a real transformation. When we die, and one day we will, that's one other thing. This is not good to remember. If we can begin every day thinking, today is going to be the last day of my life. Not a very pleasant thought, but if we can begin every day and saying, today might be the last day of my life, and how would I want the last day of my life to be? Would I want to fight with people, be nasty to people, be selfish, be angry, quarrelsome? Well, we sometimes might enjoy doing that, but none of us want to do it at the last day of our life. Last day of our life, we just want just very peaceful. Now, we don't know when the last day of our life is going to be. So it's much more practical to begin every day telling, today might be the last day of my life. And then live through that day as if it is the last day. And then you go to sleep. Next morning, when you wake up, if you find that you're still in your bed and not in some other place, that means God has given me one more day to become a better human being. So this actually, believe it or not, it's a very helpful spiritual practice. In the beginning, it might seem a little not very a happy thing to do it. But once you get over that and just tell yourself, this is going to be the last day of my life, you will see your life will change. Your family will start loving you more if you start thinking that way, because the way you speak, the way you do things, it's going to be very different. And one day you're going to be right. One day is going to be the last day. We don't want to be right very quickly, but one day we will be right. So that's one way of practicing it. In fact, a group of college students once visited Swamiji, and Swamiji asked them this question. He said, what is the most wonderful thing in the world? And the college students were smart enough to just keep quiet. They knew that Swamiji himself will answer that question, which he did. And Swamiji said, look here, we'll all die one day. How will that be the most wonderful thing in the world? And then one of the disciples asked Swamiji after that said, keep that thought always in your mind that I'm going to die one day. Then the disciple said, Swamiji, will that not make me morose and sad? And then Swamiji said, yes, of course it will make you morose and sad. But hold on. That's the important thing. Hold on to that thought. And he said, once we hold on, again, what Swamiji meant was not obsessing over death. That's a very unhealthy way to do it. But there is a healthy way to think about death. And if we can look upon death in that positive, constructive way and hold on to that thought, Swamiji says, let days and months and weeks pass. But if you hold on to that idea that one day I'm going to die, the strength of the lion will enter into you. Because the one thing that we all try to run away from is just the notion, I'm going to die one day. And we don't want to think about it. If we don't think about it, doesn't mean it's not going to happen. And that's among all the uncertainties of life. If there is one thing that's going to happen, is that we're going to die. We make so many plans. Most of the plans don't work out. Most of the plans are for things that never happen. But here is this one thing that's absolutely going to happen. And how many of us have a plan for it? So one plan would be, and give it a try if you don't, at least try it for a few days and see. Begin the day by just telling yourself, I might die today. This might be the last day today. So let me use this day to remember God, to do what is right, to do what is good, to be sweet, kind and loving with everyone. And you will see, it will really help. So I want to conclude by mentioning a few things. One way would be the four yogas that I mentioned. So I will mention to you something that we can start doing right away. Now this is something I have already mentioned here once when I spoke here sometime back. So some of you might remember, and even if you don't remember, or if you remember, it's still helpful. Before I tell you about that, I'll just mention one thing. Most of you who have been coming to the mat for a while have had the chance to hear Swami Ranganathanji Maharaj. Something for me? All that. I will carry on till it's no problem. So Swami Ranganathanji Maharaj, he said, now I remember that my link was cut. So Swami Ranganathanji Maharaj, many of us here have had a chance to listen to him and be blessed by him. And so we know that he was one of the foremost teachers of Vedanta, who taught not only in different parts of our own country, but has gone all over the world. He's given literally thousands of lectures. So I remember once, many years ago, I asked him this question and I said, Maharaj, you have given so many lectures in so many places. How do you get so much material to speak on? How can you get so many ideas to keep on speaking year after year after year to thousands and thousands of people? And then he smiled and then he just said this, people forget. And I must thank you for forgetting, because if all of you remembered everything, the Swamis will have nothing more to speak on. And therefore, I'm now going to say something that I did speak about the last time I was in Chennai. And so, it's helpful, even if you remember what it is. And that is about, sometimes when you read these books, and sometimes it can be a little bit intimidating. We might think, oh, there is so much to do. When will I do it? And what should I do? Where do I begin? All of these questions can come. And that's one of the obstacles really in spiritual life. And that is to somehow think that, oh, God realization is going to take a long time. All these rishis, they meditated for thousands of years. What am I? I'm just doing a little bit of japa, 15 minutes in the morning, 15 minutes in the evening. How can God realization come? And so it's really going to take a long time. Actually, thinking like that is a problem. Because how do we know it's going to take a long time? If we truly believe that God's grace can come anytime, then to think that, oh, it's going to take a long time is actually not having enough faith in God. A sign that our devotion has grown, has matured, would mean every time you sit for a prayer, or sit to do your japa or meditation, you sit with the conviction, who knows, today Holy Mother will come and give me freedom, I'll be a Jivan Mukta. It's possible. Why not? Because if I'm not ready, if I'm not even expecting it, then Mother might come and I'm not even expecting it, so I may not even recognize it. The grace might come, I might not even know it. So we have to be always alert and recognize that it doesn't have to take a long time. Swamiji said in one place, if the Divine Mother wants, she can make us free this very moment. We don't have to. So sometimes if you sit for meditation and then say, now I'm going to meditate for the next 10 minutes and after that I have to go shopping, I have to do these 10 different things, what it really means is that I know that by this 10 minute of japa, nothing much is going to happen. Then only I start making plans of what I'm going to do after meditation. But if I sit with the faith that who knows, by God's grace, today itself I might be Jivan Mukta. You may not have to go shopping at all. You may already be a realized person. That is Shraddha. So when we speak about Shraddha, I think that is something that we need to keep in mind as well. So one way we can start beginning, where we can make a beginning, one of the ways would be clearly, I mean obviously, one way would be those of us who have already received guidance from our gurus, the best way of course is to follow the instructions of our guru. Nothing can be better than that. Sometimes we think, oh, these instructions are so simple, I need to do something more, I want to read 100 other books. We really don't need that. For our own enlightenment, in order to have God's vision, whatever we have got, those of us who are initiated, whatever we have been taught by our teacher, if I practice that with regularity, with sincerity, with devotion, that is more than enough to give me everything. So that's one thing, obviously. When we look at these books and if we see, okay, what now, what are the things that I can start practicing right away? So for those kind of questions, here are some of the things that we can do right away. Even before you start being very philosophical or even before you start reading a lot of scriptures, one thing that we can start practicing immediately. And those things are in a set of four. And there's two things that we need to forget in our daily life, and there are two things that we need to remember. And these four things are based on actually Swamiji's four yogas. So here is a starting point. I'm not suggesting that this in itself is enough. All that I'm saying is, this could be a starting point. So what are the things that we can do? First thing is, we should continue to do good things in life. Many of us are already doing a lot of good work, and we should continue doing that. But we should do it with a little bit differently, and that is to do good, to do what is right, and just forget about it. That is something many of us are not able to do. We do good things and then we remember, oh, I have done this, I have donated so much, I have gone and helped these people. That's so much a burden that we are carrying. What it does ultimately, it just makes me very egoistic, makes me feel I am more charitable than all these people. I am so good, much better than everybody. That doesn't help in spiritual life at all. So to be spiritual means to continue doing good work, but immediately forgetting about it. In fact, even if you do something good and someone comes and thanks you for it, the ideal you should say, what have I done that you are thanking me for it? So even that idea of a doership should go away. That's one practice, to continue doing good and Actually, the idea of karma can help us in this. And that is, if you help someone, and you might think that I have helped that person, but actually, it is the good karma of that person that attracted that help. And I was only a postman carrying that help and delivering it. So I don't need to be take any credit for it. So even the idea of karma can help me continue doing good, but not feel egoistic about it. So that's first practice. Do good and forget. If I don't forget, then among the difficulties that can occur is, think about it this way. Let's say you have some puja at your home, and then you invite a friend, a family whom you have known for some time, you invite them, feed them well, and then after a month or two, there is a puja in their home, and they don't invite you. And then you suddenly feel, I invited them, I fed them so much, but they are not inviting me. These are such bad people, and next time I'm never going to do it. Now all this happened because that I invited them and fed them, that's a great thing. But I never forgot it. I kept it in my mind, and so an expectation came that they should somehow return the favor that I did to them. And that is what is a hurdle in spiritual life. So first thing, first practice, keep on doing all the good that you can do and just forget about it. And that is really what karma yoga means. Continue to do what is right, continue to do what is good, but don't hold on to that. Just let go. That's the first practice. The second practice is, other people might have hurt me somewhere. Other people sometimes could have done something which brought me a lot of pain and suffering. And that's very difficult to forget. So the second practice is, forget all the bad things that other people have done to you. Now that's really tough. People forget, not only find it difficult to forget what somebody has done to you, what your father did to my father, your grandfather did to my grandfather. Sometimes for generations, this kind of enmity remains and takes away the peace of mind of people. And so simple way would be, now how do we forget? How can we understand? If somebody brings me suffering, how can I forget about it? And one way would be to say that whatever I'm suffering from is a result of my own karma. And that person was only delivering me my karma phal. Why should I? It's a little bit like, look, in the olden days, nowadays of course, with email and stuff like that, you don't need any postman to bring your telegram. But I think those of us of old enough here know that there was such a thing as a telegram at one time. How many of you remember that there was a telegram? Well, at least quite a good number, yes. So in those days, sometimes, if a telegram came, because it wasn't such a common way of communicating, the first thing was, I hope somebody is dead. But sometimes, oftentimes, that was the reason the telegram used to come. Now suppose the telegram, the postman delivered the telegram and bring some very bad news. You don't beat up that postman. The postman hasn't done anything. The postman has simply carried it. Of course, it brought me, that news brought me pain, but the postman is not responsible for it. So similarly, if I see that some person has brought me pain, I have to say, that pain was something that was delivered to me by my own karma. And that person who brought the pain was only an instrument, was only a postman. Why beat the postman? That's one way of understanding that. But more importantly, what this does, it gives us the peace of mind. If I'm a spiritual seeker, if I have to sit daily and do my prayer and japa and meditation, then if I carry all this grudge in my heart, that is what is going to come in my mind. I'm going to realize the grudge. I'm not going to realize God. Because whatever is in my mind, that is what I'm going to realize. So if I want my mind to be free from all these concerns and keep it focused on my ishta, then I should forget all the harm, all the suffering, all the pain that other people have given me, and I should forget all the good things that I have done to other people. Actually, it's extremely liberating. You feel free if that happens. So this practice of forgetting the harm that other people have done to us, that needs an amount of control over the mind. And therefore, this practice is more akin to a practice of Raja Yoga, of how to have control over the mind, that I control my mind's reactions. So two things. First, forget all the good that you have done to other people. But continue doing good, just forget about it. Otherwise say, if I have to forget about it, why do good at all? That's not the idea. Keep on doing good, just forget about it afterwards. And then, if people have, okay, now just kind of a corollary to it. If people do bad to you, forget about it. But if people do something good to you, be grateful for it. That's one of the very important dharmas of our tradition, gratitude. The more we learn to be grateful in our life, we will see we'll have very little time to hate anyone. Virtually from every person we meet, from our close family, to our relatives, to our friends, even the person that you see on the street, some way or the other, everyone has contributed towards me in being the kind of person I am. So be grateful. Be grateful to living beings. Be grateful to the environment. Be grateful that there is oxygen still in the air that I can breathe and live. Be grateful that there is still some drinking water available. Otherwise, we would die. If with that sense of gratitude, it will teach me more responsibility. I will learn then not to waste water. Especially in Chennai, we know, or some years ago, there's such a great water scarcity. If I learn the value of gratitude, I will have the responsibility then to preserve what is so important for us. So two things, forget all the good that you are doing, forget all the bad that other things have done to you. Okay, now just two more things. To remember that everything passes away in life. Nothing remains. That's such a great relief that no matter how terrible things might seem, it's never going to be permanent. It's like the clouds. You see a certain cloud formation in the sky, and after some time, the clouds have moved on. Sometimes the clouds are dark and terrible. Sometimes the clouds are very pretty. But they never stay in one place. So similarly, things in our life as well. There are wonderful things happening in our life. There are terrible things happening in our life. But they are all transitory. They are all temporary. They all move on. With that way, first of all, we know if you are suffering, that's not going to be there all the time, which is a great relief. But on the other hand, if there is good times that we are passing through, we will know that also is not going to remain all the time. And so, since the good things are also not going to remain all the time, I will learn to then respect it and relish it and enjoy it. Lot of times, even the good things happening in our life, we don't have patience to wait it because they're worried about what's going to come later on. So the responsibility to enjoy and relish the blessings in life will come to us if we recognize that everything is temporary. And that recognition comes, that's a part of Jnana Yoga, to look deeply with Viveka in the life around us, what's happening in our own body and mind, and recognize everything changes. And then the last practice is to know that everything changes. There's one thing that never changes. One being who is always there, and that is God. So God is the only unchanging reality, the only unchanging presence in our lives. And the recognition of that comes under Bhakti Yoga. So I briefly mentioned that if we want to start undertaking a study of the four yogas, then these could be the starting points. A simple thing that we all can begin practicing just right away He doesn't have to say, I'm going to start next year after 5 years. No, we can start practicing right away. Because it's so simple. One, keep on doing good. Just forget about it after doing. Don't carry that weight of your goodness on you. Forget all the bad things that other people have done to you. Remember that everything is transitory, everything is temporary. And remember that God alone is real. God alone exists. So these are the ways that can provide us an entry point into practicing Swamiji's teachings in our own daily life. So I began by saying that there is a public celebration and there is a private celebration. Public celebration is what we had throughout the day today. And that is so inspiring, so uplifting. The puja, the prasad, the bhajan, the singing, it's extremely uplifting. But this public celebration will become fulfilled, will help us grow spiritually if it is accompanied by a private celebration. And a private celebration occurs in the depth of our own heart. That is where we can celebrate Swamiji being born inside our heart. And Swamiji being born inside our heart means that he begins to live in the way we think, in the way we speak, in the way we do our work, in the way we relate with other people. So when it is said that Swamiji is still living today, that Swamiji didn't pass away in 1902, what it means is, where is Swamiji living? And Swamiji is living in the hearts of every one of us. And that will become clear only if we make sure that our thinking, our speaking, our working begins to be influenced by Swamiji's life and Swamiji's words. That is the way Swamiji will continue to live in generation after generation, and he'll continue. He himself said, I will cast off this body like a worn out garment. I'll continue to inspire people everywhere. How will he do that? Through you and me. If we live, we are inspired here by Swamiji's life. If we build our life accordingly, if we treat our family members, our friends, the society in which we move, if we treat them all the way Swamiji would have expected us to do so, then through us, Swamiji is living. Through our work, Swamiji is living. And then the next generation who see and feel inspired by that, they will then begin to follow, and Swamiji's work this way will continue generation after generation after generation. So I would conclude by a prayer that through the infinite grace of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother and Swamiji, may they illumine our hearts and may we find that peace, joy, fulfillment and perfection in our life now and always. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.